Hello again, everyone. Hello, hello, hello. Your attention, please. The program is resuming. If you can hear the sound of my voice, please applaud so people know the program is resuming.
Thank you.
I like to pretend the applause is for me, but I know that's not true. We have a schedule to keep here. We want to make sure you have some Q&A time for Dr. Laffer. Oh, hello, Greg. It's good to see you. At any rate, the crowd, we have a lot of people are going to be joining us here in just a minute through the wonder of technology, and Roger's going to explain what that's all about here. But you got to love the technology. We're everywhere. You're here. That's the great thing that you're here and be part of this really historic occasion. Probably more so than you think, and we'll unfold that with Dr. Laffer in a minute. To officially introduce our guest speaker today, I'd like to introduce Raj Kanapan, who is the director of YAF's Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, which is increasingly foreign to some of the candidates running out there. Like, well, don't you just find the top 1% and then you just bleed every spare change out of it, and then somehow miraculously government makes everything work. I don't know about you, but I like liberty and freedom, and let's go with that. Sometimes when they say, some people have to work more than one job, it's like, I've got five of them by choice. I don't have to ask anybody. That's entrepreneurship. So Raj has been leading the foundation efforts to educate and inspire students to advance free market ideas among his peers. His focus is growing the share of young people who adopt free enterprise philosophy through free market student conferences and seminars, campus lectures, and digital and print content. He graduated from Cornell University, where he studied government, economics, and Southeast Asian affairs. He served as chairman of his campus's conservative organization, wrote for the Cornell Review as well. He's been involved in various foundation programs, including the 9/11 Never Forget Project, hosting lectures by Karl Rove and Mark Thiessen, and participating in the foundation's fall conference here at the Reagan Ranch. Please welcome Raj to properly introduce our speaker today.
Thanks, Mark. Welcome back to our Wendy P. McCaw Reagan Ranch Roundtable Luncheon commemorating the 38th anniversary of the 1981 tax cuts. It's a great time to be together here. And as Mark mentioned, it is a momentous occasion. For those of you watching on online via Virtual Pass, our YouTube channel and Facebook, welcome. I know there are thousands of you watching, so we're glad you're here joining us today. You can visit yaf.org/virtualpass if you're not already on there. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, you can switch over to Virtual Pass and also submit your questions there for today's event. Our guest of honor today, Dr. Laffer, has also asked that we share with you two special videos, which we'll post online towards the end of today's event or email you afterwards. The first video is a video of his Medal of Freedom ceremony at the White House with President Donald Trump. And the second is a reenactment of the Laffer Curve with Dick Cheney. As Mark mentioned, I'm Raj Kanapan, the director of Young America's Foundation Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise. Many of you here today and watching online have, in all likelihood, been involved with YAF for a number of years, whether as supporters, students, or friends. You're involved with YAF because of your desire and commitment to inspire young people with the ideas of individual freedom, limited government, and free enterprise. Over the course of your recent involvement with YAF's efforts, you've probably noticed a change. Something different even from just 3, 4, or 5 years ago. We have a growing new challenge on our hands, one that many thought had been discarded onto the ash heap of history. Andy Puzder, who is also a frequent speaker for YAF, recently served as CEO of CKE Restaurants, and a friend of YAF put it well in a conversation I recently had with him. He said, in 1991, with the fall of the Soviet Union, all of us who believed in free enterprise and free markets breathed a sigh of relief. The joke at the time was that the only place you could find a socialist was at the faculty lounge at Harvard. But now socialists and socialism seem to be expanding to other colleges and even our K-12 education system. Indeed, it's quite easy to find evidence of socialist thinking on our country's college campuses. Each year, YAF audits the course catalogs at universities and colleges around the country to study the kind of history, economics, and civics students are being taught on campus. What we find is a collection of anti-free enterprise, anti-American courses being peddled as education in exchange for $40, $50, $60, even $70,000 in tuition and room and board each year. Here are just a few examples from this particular year. The University of Wisconsin-Madison, one of the largest public universities in the country, offers a course titled Class, State, and Ideology, an introduction to social science in the Marxist tradition, which teaches that free enterprise produces a world of great misery, inequality, and oppression. Williams College, the top-ranked liberal arts college in the country, offers a course named Racial Capitalism, which interrogates the ways in which capitalist economies have always and everywhere relied upon forms of racist domination. Those are in quotes. And of course, Claremont McKenna College, just a couple of hours from here, the Reagan Ranch Center, offers a course titled Income Inequality, Politics, and Public Policy, Class, Race, and Gender. I think you get the idea, so you can probably write the course description yourself. But this is the climate on campuses today, and why YAF's work with students is so important. Our work reveals that young people are actually not locked into a particular set of ideas about free enterprise and about the role of government in society. The real challenge is that too many young people are receiving too little good education on economics, business, and the merits of our free enterprise system. In survey after survey, many young people today state that they prefer socialism to free enterprise, but they cannot define either. Many state they want more government involvement, but they cannot justify this intervention in their own lives. Many also conflate free enterprise and cronyism. Young America's Foundation is addressing this growing challenge through our Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise. We focus squarely on educating and training young people to understand and advocate for free market ideas among their peers on campus and as they graduate and enter their professional careers. We achieve this by providing a range of programs absent on their campuses, including our conferences and seminars, our educational content both online and in print, and our Free Enterprise Campus Lecture Program. Historically, YAF has achieved success in this space, developing students who go on to become leaders in business and the free enterprise area, and in promoting leaders in the field to reach student audiences around the country. YAF's alumni include leaders like Todd Buchholz, former White House Director of Economic Policy, Peter Thiel, technology investor and co-founder of PayPal, and Larry Reed, who until recently served as the president of the Foundation for Economic Education. Our partners in educating students over the years have included leaders such as Nobel Prize-winning economist Milton Friedman, Vernon Smith, and James Buchanan, faculty members including Dr. Bert Folsom and Dr. Walter Williams, and business leaders including Forbes Media Chairman Steve Forbes and Andy Puzzer. We have had no greater friend in recent years in our efforts than our guest today, Dr. Arthur Laffer. Dr. Laffer is the founder and chairman of Laffer Associates, an institutional economic research and consulting firm, and Laffer Investments, an investment management firm. He launched his career in academia, achieving tenure in the University of Chicago Economics Department at the age of 28. One of his earliest successes in shaping public policy was actually here in the state of California. He was involved in Proposition 13, the groundbreaking California initiative that drastically cut property taxes in the state in 1978. He went on to play a key role in influencing the tax-cutting movement of the 1980s, advising both President Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. He served on President Reagan's Economic Policy Advisory Board for both of his terms in office. And more recently, Dr. Laffer worked with President Donald Trump to develop and pass the 2017 tax cuts. I think that deserves another round. It's no exaggeration to say that he's helped improve the lives of millions of people worldwide. A longtime ally of Young America's Foundation, Dr. Laffer has spoken at our signature National Conservative Student Conference in Washington, D.C. At this very event, on the 30th anniversary of the 1981 Reagan tax cuts, and at YAF's national headquarters in Washington, outside of Washington, D.C. Over the last 2 years, he's also barnstormed the nation's campuses, from Yale University to the University of Notre Dame to the University of Utah, partnering with YAF to make an articulate and principled case for free enterprise among students around the country. He tells it like it is, with energy, optimism, and a joy that are infectious. Students and even faculty members find his approach compelling, and they routinely tell us how impressed they are with his ability to simplify the most complex ideas and models. Adding to his long list of accolades, Dr. Laffer recently received the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor, from President Donald Trump. President Trump began his remarks by stating, "Few people in history have revolutionized economic thought and policy like Dr. Art Laffer. It's hard to top that, but I do have one more note to add. This Wednesday is Dr. Laffer's birthday. So I want to ask all of you to join me in a rousing rendition of Happy Birthday." And we do have a cupcake for you, which we'll box up. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear doctor. Happy birthday to you. Please welcome Dr. Art Laffer.
Thank you very much. I just want you to realize that cupcake has only one candle, which stands for 79 years. Oh my gosh. Raj, thank you very much. I'm going to mix the days up a little bit, just if I may. It's really fun to be back here. The ranch is really inspiring, isn't it? And you got to admit, Young America's Foundation is the best ever. I mean, I'm going to circle back. Obviously, Ronald Reagan is intimately associated with the ranch, with the Young America's Foundation. But also, as you may know, William F. Buckley, Jr. Also founded the Young America's Foundation and then adopted by Ronald Reagan. So I'm going to come back and circle back with you on one story about a firing line when Ronald Reagan and Bill Buckley were on together. And I'm going to tell you another little story at the end of that. But, you know, it's such a wonderful day, the anniversary of the signing of the tax bill. I mean, it just doesn't get any better than that. It's also, as Raj mentioned, it's also the anniversary of the first day I spent on planet Earth, 79 years ago. Now, those are two wonderful events. There have been some ugly events on this day. I don't know if any of you are aware, but on August 13th, 1961, I happened to be living in Germany at the time, and I was in Berlin at the youth hostel. I'd gone through East Berlin for 2 days before that and then came back. I was traveling with two students, colleagues, well, same age as I was, from Leipzig. They were in math and chemistry, and I came back to the West and was at the youth hostel. And that night, we were awakened in the middle of the night by troops and tanks and all that happening. It was the day they built the wall. There's another ugly little fact today I don't want to match the beauty of today with all ugliness, but the elections in Argentina yesterday went very, very badly for free enterprise, for pro-growth, and Argentina is in the spiral, downward spiral. So it's a very exciting day, working in all directions. Now, I want to take you back in time, if I may, and have a little fun with you. It was in Los Angeles, 1979, and this is when the revelation hit me. Now, I'd loved Ronald Reagan forever and ever, and I had to. My godfather was a man named Justin Dart, if any of you know that. So being my youngest son is named Justin. So I've always loved Ronald Reagan. I mean, just have always. But the revelation of what really Ronald Reagan was at the Beverly Hills Hotel, 1979. And Dick Allen, any of you remember who Dick Allen was? The first national security advisor for then Governor Reagan and then President Reagan when he came into office. And we had this little group of us, maybe 11 or 12 of us sitting there in this little room just talking about it. And the governor said to Dick Allen, he said, Dick, would you mind doing me a favor? Would you sort of summarize in intuitive terms just the post-World War II history of the United States? And just to get the conversation going, if you wouldn't mind, and Dick said, and Dick has this sense of humor that's just to die for. He said, yes, sir, I'd be more than happy to do. Two things have happened in the post-World War II era for the United States. We've done nothing but harass our friends and cajole our enemies. And with that, Reagan looks back quizzically and goes, excuse me, Dick, what did you say? He said, sir, we've done nothing but cajole our enemies and harass our friends. And the governor leaned back and said, well, Dick, what has been the consequence of those policies? He said, well, two things, sir. We have almost no friends left in the world, but we have lots and lots of enemies. And seriously, this is at the moment there, he just leans back. There's just a moment of breath, and he said, you know, Dick, we're just going to have to reverse those policies now, aren't we? We're going to have to make our friends stinking rich with supply-side economics, and we're going to have to scare the bejabers out of our enemies with Star Wars. And it was at that moment I realized that we were at an inflection point in the world. I mean, I don't think he used exactly those words, but that is exactly what he said. And you had a change in the earth that was amazing. That's when I sort of, my sight had always been on the ground, and then I lifted it up, and you could see a complete change in the universe as a result. The tax bills, the whole economic package of Ronald Reagan. I mean, what an exciting, exciting time. When we took office on January 20th, 1981, the highest marginal income tax rate in America was 70%. I mean, think of that, 70%. And that's just the personal income tax at a federal level. It didn't count California and all these other ones and sales tax, blah, 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 all that other stuff. I mean, it was just amazing. 70% was the highest rate. And he brought that rate down to 28%. Do you consider that a tax cut? Yeah. Is that good enough for you? Let me just warm you up. If you look at the capital gains tax, I think was at that time was, 39.9%. He brought it down to 28%. Corporate tax, 46% to 34%. And I could go on and on with the regulations, the trade, the freeing of trade, all of this stuff. I mean, it was an era of absolute beauty in America. If you look at the prosperity. Now, let me, if I can, just quickie comparisons, and there are all sorts of records on this, and you can go look at all the numbers you want and go geeky on me. But if you compare the trough and the recession to the months afterwards, 36 months afterwards, all right, and compare Obama with Reagan, all right, from the trough of the recession, both of them starting at the same bottom. Remember when Obama came in, the economy was way down, and then you look at the next 36 months, and you look at Reagan, same thing. Reagan created 14 million more jobs than did Obama. Reagan's real GDP grew by enough to give us $3.5 trillion more dollars worth of GDP. And if you look at the stock market, if you look at the stock market from August 13th, 1981 to the present, August 13th, 1982 to the present, not to the present, to the end of his term there, the stock market was up 737% in real terms. From 1966 until 1982, in the 16 and a half years before that, the market was down at an average annual rate of 7.9% per annum for 16 and a half years. That's called a depression, people. I mean, the decline in that, the stock market fell by 77% in 16 and a half years. I mean, it's incredible when you see the prosperity that's gone on there. I mean, if you look at the growth rates in real GDP from the trough of the recession, under Reagan, it was 4.7% growth till the end of his term. On Barack Obama, I think it was 2.4%. from the trough of the recession on in growth. I mean, from January 1st, 1983, when our tax cuts took effect, to June 30th, 1984, in that period, 18-month period, the real GDP grew by 12%. Now, let me just say, in 18 months, a year and a half, real GDP grew by 12%. That's at an 8% per annum compound rate growth rates. That's Chinese growth rates. You know, when you look at this world, it's absolutely shocking, and it's so exciting about what has happened in the world during that period. Now, when you think about what Reagan was doing during this whole period, and it's in regulations, the five pillars of prosperity, what he was trying to do is change tax codes to make them far more efficient. Tried to get government spending down. It was awful hard during that period to do that. Sound monetary policy. Do any of you remember what the inflation rate was when we took office on January 20th, 1981? The inflation rate was over even that. The prime interest rate was 21.5%. Can you imagine an economy with 21.5% prime interest rate? Well, we had one then. And it all came down. He brought that down. If you look at trade policy, he moved the NAFTA. He pushed for very major trade restrictions and cuts to create increased growth and prosperity in the world. Deregulation. Remember him holding that book of federal regulations on the podium? And he boom, drops it. I mean, if you look at the number of pages in the Federal Register, you can just see him coming down. I mean, what an era of prosperity it was, and just exciting as all get out. Now, when you think about the tax codes and what he was trying to do, it's obvious, it's so obvious. But all taxes are bad. Some are worse than others. What you want to do with tax codes is you want to collect your revenue in the least damaging fashion. Now, obviously, you want to spend the money in the most beneficial fashion. And when the damage done by the last dollar of taxes collected is a less than the benefit done by the last dollar spent, you stop already. Anything beyond that is too much government. Everything below that's too little government. That's the rightful role of government, period. But the most efficient thing is you want the lowest possible tax rate on the broadest possible tax base. So you provide people with the least incentives to evade, avoid, or otherwise not report taxable income. And so you provide the least places in your tax codes where people can hide money and not pay their taxes. What you want is a low, broad-based, flat tax in the system, and that's the thing to create the prosperity. Reagan understood that, and the movement that we did during the 80s, that he did during the 80s, was just astounding. Look at the prosperity of that period. I'm not going to dwell any more on that, but I am going to dwell on one other part of Ronald Reagan, which is with the other founder of the Young Americas Foundation, a guy named William F. Buckley. And it's Reaganomics all over, but only at a state level. I've given all of you a paper today. It should be on your chair on Illinois. And Illinois is an example of what not to do. I don't know if any of you heard the story, and I'll tell you the story. Reagan was on firing line with Bill Buckley, and they got into state economics, and it was just perfect. If you hear Reagan talking about state economics, you know, the people have the right to vote with their feet. He said something along the lines of taxes don't redistribute income, they redistribute people. I'm going to tell you a little story on this, but first I want to tell you, I was introducing Scott Walker 2 days ago in Nashville. And I was walking up to the big convention center we have there, and I was overhearing two people talking, and just I listened. And the one guy said, have you heard the story about the couple who lived and worked their whole lives in Tennessee and then upped and moved to Illinois? And the other guy says, no, I haven't heard that story. The guy says, and you never will. Supply-side economics works in all domains, and I just want to remind you of one story, and then I'll sit down and do questions or whatever you want. There were 11 states in this country of ours that have introduced the income tax since 1960. 11 states. First one was West Virginia in 1961. They put in the income tax. There hadn't been one there before. Other states that did it. The last one, of course, was Connecticut under Lowell Weicker, who introduced it, and that was in 1991. If you look at these 11 states, they're fairly normal, everyday states. You know, you've got Rhode Island. You've obviously got West Virginia. You've got Maine. You've got New Jersey. You've got Connecticut, obviously. You've got Pennsylvania. You've got Ohio. You've got Michigan. You've got Illinois. You've got Indiana. You've got Nebraska. I mean, I don't know if I've hit all 11, but these are everyday normal states. And I want to take you through this story. What I did was I took every one of those 11 states, and I looked at each of those states relative to the rest of the country. You following me here? All right, I took each of those 11 states. I took the 5 years before they introduced the income tax and what their performance was relative to the rest of the nation. You follow me? I looked at all the major economic metrics. I looked at their population. I looked at their employment. I looked at their gross state product. I looked at their tax revenues. I looked at all the major economic metrics of each of these states 5 years before they introduced the income tax and in the latest 5 years. Okay? And I looked at what happened to each of these states after they put in the income tax. Every single one of those states, every single one, without one exception, declined relative to the rest of the nation in each and every single metric. Every single one did. And not by a little bitty bit, by huge amounts. Some of the states you'll recognize, Michigan. Michigan before Romney put in the income tax, not Mitt, although he probably would have, never mind. Sorry, that just was a little off slip. I'm no politician. Just, I mean, when Romney put in the income tax in Michigan, Michigan was about 5.2% of the U.S. economy. Today, Michigan is a little bit less than 2.7% of the U.S. economy. That's catastrophic. 1950, Detroit had a population of 1.85 million. Today, Detroit has a population less than 600,000. My home state of Ohio, I was born in Youngstown, raised in Cleveland. My state has done well. The one I love telling the story about, and I'm going to tell about, is New Jersey. It's just such a delicious little story that, forgive me, you know, you all know New Jersey. Think of this now. Think of this today. In 1965, New Jersey had neither an income tax nor a sales tax. Neither one. Fastest growing state in the nation. People from everywhere were moving to New Jersey, and they had a balanced budget. 9 years ago, before Chris Christie, when my student, a guy named John Corzine, was governor of New Jersey, and he was a student of mine at the University of Chicago when I taught there, and just in full disclosure, and transparency, a C student. And just to be totally clear, with all the knowledge of MF Global and all that, I'm not even sure he earned the C. They had the highest property taxes, highest sales taxes, highest income taxes, the most taxed state in the nation. I mean, it was incredible. Slowest growing state in the nation. People were leaving New Jersey like rats out of a sinking ship, and they had a huge budget deficit. You know, when you look at supply-side economics, it's not just the U.S. that it works in. It works in states. It works in countries. It's the world over. The key element to all of this debate today, and I want to bring it back to the politics of today, because the politics of today are the exact same they've been for generations. Anyone think a current Democratic candidate is any different than George McGovern? I'll tell you, they're not. Do you remember George McGovern's $15,000 Democrat? To every American, they wanted to give $15,000. Yeah, I don't know if you remember that. It's too funny to be true, but it's but let me take you through redistribution, which is just math. And I'm a professor in math, and I just want to do the math. Redistribution is when you redistribute income from those who have a little bit more to those who have a little bit less. You with me? Now, when you redistribute from those who have a little bit more and give it to those who have a little bit less, by taking some from those who have a little bit more, you reduce their incentives to produce, and they will produce a little bit less. You follow me? I want to make sure we're all on the same page. It's math, people. It's not Republican. It's not Democrat. It's not liberal. It's not conservative. It's not left-wing. It's not right-wing. It's called economics. Now, when you give that little bit more that you took from the guy who had a little bit more, and you give it to the guy who has a little bit less, that guy, in turn, has an alternative source of income other than working. And that person, too, will work a little bit less. You follow me? So when you take it from those who have a little bit more, they'll work a little bit less and produce a little bit less. And you give it to someone who has a little bit less, that person, too, will produce a little bit less than they otherwise would. The theorem here is just math. Whenever you redistribute income, you always reduce total income, period. Now, that's math. That's not left-wing, that's not right-wing, that's none of this stuff. And I really would love to get some of my counterparts on the left to talk about some of their candidates' proposals. Just, I'd love to. Now, the lemma from this theorem is cool. The lemma, of course, you can see clearly. The more you redistribute, the greater will be the loss in total income. You all see that clearly? So the theorem is any redistribution of income causes a drop in total income. And the more you redistribute, the greater will be the drop in total income. Now, the limit function of this theorem is also beautiful. If you were, by chance, to be able to redistribute all income so that everyone came out the same, there will be no income. Now, let me try to make this intuitive to you. If you were to redistribute income so that everyone came out the same, what you would have to do is you'd have to tax everyone above the average income, 100% of the excess, okay? And what you'd have to do is subsidize everyone below the average income up to the average income. You with me? Now, if you actually were to do that, if you actually were to tax everyone who made above the average income 100% of the excess and subsidize everyone below the average income up to the average income, I will stipulate today, counselor, everyone will come out even at zero income. When you look at politics and economics, remember this theorem, period. You know, it is the most important thing. And with that, I just want to say, Young America's Foundation, you're the dream of the future. You're what we all hope for and aspire to. And thank you very much for all you do for this country. Thank you. Raj, shall I just take questions from here?
Thank you so much for Dr. Laffer. Yes. We will start out. We have our virtual pass attendees. They are our students who are attending across the country. We will start out with a question from them. Gina will read that aloud. And then we will start out with questions here in the room. So if you have a question, please raise your hand, and either Gina or I will come over and hand you the mic. Thank you.
Make it a nice one, Gina.
Well, this first one's coming from Mark Wolf. He's from Austin, Texas. And the question is, why do you think so many people can't seem to understand the concept that a nation could lower tax rates and then receive more tax revenue? Isn't it just like a store having a sale and making more money in the end?
Unfortunately, it is that simple. I try to pretend the Laffer curve is profound and deep and intellectual, but it's not. It's trivially obvious. When we cut the taxes with Reagan, The highest income earners who had the biggest tax cuts, of course, the amount of tax revenues from the top 1% went way, way up, not down. Cut tax on them by 42%. I think revenues from them went up 112% from the top 1%. If you look at the same thing that happened in the 1920s, when we cut the highest tax rate from 77% to 25%, the tax revenues from the top 1% went from 15% of total revenues to 67%. It's the same thing that happened when Kennedy cut the highest tax rate from 91 to 70%. The rich paid a lot more in taxes. It's obvious that that's how it works. But, you know, as Larry Gatlin says, it ain't rocket surgery. Oh, you finally got it, did you?
Thank you again for coming to Santa Barbara. We love it when you come. Why Nashville? Why not Arizona, Texas, other states that have low taxes? Is it just the Gatlin brothers, or is there something else going on?
Texas is lovely. I love it. Arizona is wonderful. I spent the war there with my grandparents. You know, just lovely places. But Tennessee happens to be the lowest tax state in the nation, if you include severance taxes. Now, the Tax Foundation does not include severance taxes, so that Tennessee is the third lowest, not the lowest. We have no income tax. We got rid of our hall tax, our unearned income tax. We have no death tax. We have no gift tax. We have eighth lowest property tax in the nation. Now, we do have a hefty sales tax, but that's our workhorse. That's where we collect our revenues. You know, and even on the sales tax, I think we're 12th highest in the nation. We're by no means the highest. If you look at all taxes, Tennessee is the single lowest tax state in the nation. It is also just about the fastest growing state in the nation. It is the tax in the nation that has the biggest surplus in their budget. Surplus, yes, largest surplus in the budget. It is the number one funded pension fund state in the nation, or number two in the right, and depends on which study you're looking at. But we're 100% funding of all pensions in state and local, and the biggest improvement in public services of any state in the nation. But other than that, it's really a lousy state. So, plus, in Tennessee, when I moved there, I paid for my house with my first year's tax savings. Woohoo! And after 3 years, the statute of limitations expires for California. And I'm able to come back here and enjoy all this stuff without paying your taxes. You know, work is a lot more fun with lower taxes. Does that answer your question? I used to tell people, well, I shouldn't probably, well, you know, I'm a big animal raiser and stuff like that, and I'm really into animal plants. I had one of the best botanical gardens in California when I lived in Rancho, and I really am into animals and plants. I'm very involved with the San Diego Zoo. When I got to Nashville, I got involved with the zoo at Nashville. Now, it's a little country zoo. It's the Nashville Zoo at Grasmere. It's a little tiny place, but it's cute. It's lovely. It's, you know, delightful. You can go through there. You can climb in a cage with the meerkats, you know, those little plastic things, and they're jumping around. You can go back behind the scenes and the zebras and giraffes and all the blah, 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 blah. It's just really nice. There are a lot of similarities between San Diego and Nashville. I mean, San Diego Zoo and the Nashville Zoo at Grasmere. And, for example, if you go to an exhibit, on both of them they have a picture of the animal at the exhibit. And if you go then the line below that, they have the genus and species of the animal. Below that, they have the name of the animal in English there. And below that, at San Diego, at the San Diego Zoo, they have the natural history of the animal, where they live, how much they are, how much they eat, and all that sort of stuff. At the zoo in Nashville, they have the recipes for it and what wines go well with it. Sorry. Oh, sorry. Sorry.
So our next virtual pass question is coming from Virginia Patton, and she's from Kansas City, Missouri. Her question is, how has it been working with the Trump administration versus the Reagan administration?
Perfect example of the personal characteristics of both presidents are very similar except for their outward demeanor. No, but it's true. It is true. They're very similar people except how they express themselves and how they handle themselves in the public is very different. Now, if you look at the kitchen cabinet of Reagan, everyone in the kitchen cabinet was Donald Trump. I mean, really amazing. Ronald Reagan was cool, calm, collected all the time, perfectly. I mean, just amazing man. I've never seen him get angry. I mean, when he'd get a little angry, he'd go, like that. But the best thing explains it when I was with the president, this one, and he was talking about the tax bill being the best tax bill ever. And I said, well, you know, sir, my opinion is it's the best tax bill in any president's first term. And he'd lean back. He said, what do you mean, first term? And I said, well, sir, you know, you got to remember there was the 86 Tax Act. When we dropped the highest rate to 28%, we dropped the corporate from 46 to 34. But doggone it, I tried to get those guys to do more. And this is Trump. He's competitive beyond belief. And if he gets reelected, you will not imagine the policies that will be put into place. Have any of you looked at the executive orders that he's put through on transparency in medicine? Now, you know the surprise billing? Do any of you know these stories? There is a surprise. If you're out of network and you're traveling and all of a sudden you have a heart attack and you go into emergency room and they cure you, oh, my God, you feel so wonderful and everything. Thank you. And you hug the nurses and the doctor. They save you and you're driving home and you get a bill for $100,000 because you're out of network. The executive order on surprise billing is amazing. If you look at this, it really corrects one of the huge problems. The next executive order he put in is transparency. And I was chairman of the board of Centennial Hospital in Nashville, which is the flagship for HCA, if any of you know. And you know, when you look at medicine today, you have no idea what the procedures are that you take, what they cost. You don't even know enough to ask. I mean, if you look at that, no one knows what the quality of your doctor is. Not even the doctors do. The doctors don't. An MRI in Waco, Texas, was found to be $147. An MRI in, some city in Northern California, was charging $47,000. I was talking to Evan Bai, and he told me his story. And you know, he married one of my students, and I was talking to him about the Affordable Care Act, why he voted for it, because he literally was the guy on the margin. He was. I mean, you can say it was 50-50, but, you know, it wasn't. It was Evan Bai. Whichever way he went, the bill sailed or sank. And he said, you know, Art, I was going each way, and I couldn't figure out which one to do and which way to go. And all of a sudden, it hit me. My beautiful wife, Susan, your student, had this tumor below her skull there. It was benign, about the size of a plum, he said. And we had to have it removed. And we had to, do you know what the cost of that operation was? $98,000. And my only comment to him was, you're probably the stupidest senator that has ever been on planet Earth. No hospital bill is $98,000. Believe me, if that were true, that hospital would have a GDP bigger than the whole universe. That was the opening gamut that they would use when the insurance companies. And by the time they negotiated the final price, it was way less than 10% of that $98,000. Joe Kennedy, same thing happened. He had his bicycle accident in Florida. Broke all these bones, 103 breaks. I mean, they flew him back up to Mass General on life flight up there. Art, do you know what that life flight cost? It was $175,000. No, it wasn't. It was probably $15,000, $16,000, which is a nice hefty price. But all of these people have no idea what the prices are. You don't know what the prices are. You don't get any chance. How can you know what to buy? When I talked to the president about this, I said, imagine you're in construction. You get a truckload of bricks. And the guy comes up to you and says, do you want to buy them? Well, what type of bricks are they and how good are they? I'm sorry, I can't tell you that. He said, well, how much are you going to charge you for them? I'm sorry, I can't tell you that either, but do you want to buy them or not? That's what medicine is like today. You cannot have a free market in products that you don't know the price of and you don't know the quality of. And this executive order requires all hospitals, all doctors, all procedures to do in normal, understandable human units what the transactions prices are, i.e., what the insurance companies transact with the hospitals are in dollars, and what they do in the free enterprise system in dollars. This will allow medicine to become a free enterprise, private market once again. You walk into a hospital with a wad of dollar bills and say, I want an operation, and how much are you going to charge me, and I'm going to go to these other hospitals. No insurance, nothing, just there's my wad of bills, how much you charge. You'll get a price that's less than 10% of what they officially charge for it. We need to have transparency in medicine, and we need it now. We need transparency in medical procedures. How good is your doctor? You don't know. You don't have the information. You know, we need to have the information on your doctors, on medicine. We need transparency, what the pills are, what they do, what the risks are with all those. Transparency there. That's where the president is on that as well. So just so you know, and also now he's doing a special executive order on pricing of pills, of medicine, and making sure we're the most favored nation in the world. If we produce the pills, why the heck should they be paid, charged less in Canada than they should in the U.S.? I mean, it doesn't make any sense. It's our country. This is the type of stuff that's really, really transformational that's occurring. The next one is 501c3 universities. Do you realize there are $440 billion a year on 501c3 contributions? That's $170 billion in lost taxes there. If you look at Harvard University, do you think football tickets at Harvard should be tax-free? Do you think that their property taxes shouldn't be? I mean, come on, people. Harvard University is a huge, huge hedge fund with a tiny little academic institution attached to it. You know, there's nothing wrong with stuff. But these are the types of things we need to do to generate economic growth and prosperity. And you need to attack the sacred cows. Not attack them. You need to rationalize the tax system. You know, and make it for growth. Well, I'm going way beyond, but my view is that when you look at the two presidents, Reagan and Trump, their styles are very different, but their focus, their drive, their ambition, their view, their vision, their worldwide perspective was very similar. One more here. Oh, sorry, way down there. Then you're next.
And I had a question, the of how socialism in Venezuela. We could test.
Yeah. I think you're totally right. The question is, Venezuela is a country that went from capitalist to Marxist in a short order, and what happened to it? You can see the collapse and all that. You can see it in Argentina. You can see it in a number of other countries as well. And they're all great examples for illustrating what's happened and how socialism really does destroy the economy. But we have much closer examples. How many of you in here are from California? Raise your hands. I hate to tell you, that's an IQ test. You know, in 2006, I told you what I did. I left this state. If you do an analysis of why you're still here, it's not only the taxes you pay, it's what they do with your money. They then breed rats to attack you. Just joking. Look at the states. Look at the once prosperous, third fastest growing state in the nation. From 1977 to 1991 was Connecticut. Third slowest growing state since 1991 in the U.S. has been Connecticut. Look at what happened. Look what happened in New Jersey. I told you that story. I could go through West Virginia. I could go through Kentucky with you. I could go through Michigan. I did go through with you. I mean, look at these. Look at Texas. Look at Tennessee. Look at Florida. You've got the living, breathing examples here. The dream in America is not to make Tennessee look like Illinois. The dream in America is to make Illinois look like Tennessee. And once you're in the tailspin, it's really hard to pull it out. It's really tough, because what do you do? I mean, you know, what do you do? It'd be, how do you fund the school? Once you're in that tailspin, there's no easy answer. You know, it's cold turkey or nothing. And cold turkey ain't fun in a state. Don't start with the drugs. Stop the process before you get into it too badly. And I think you're right about Venezuela, but I think you're equally as right about Connect. I mean, the example the president used, I mean, you know, I lived in the south side of Chicago. In fact, you know, I lived in Jackson Park Highlands. I had 68th and Euclid is where I lived. And, you know, the story was that when my family and I moved to Southern California, my old neighborhood was no longer integrated. If you want to know what hardships are, look at the inner cities and what's happening to your country, to this population that doesn't have a chance. I mean, in 1973, I wrote something called Enterprise Zones. I don't know if any of you know what that was. But I was living in the south side of Chicago. I said, you know, what we should do here, if you want to correct it, I had a four-part program. Number one, within the Enterprise Zone, which is the inner city there in south side, no income tax, neither employer nor employee income tax on any of that stuff there, and up to, let's say, $50,000 a year income. If you think you're losing money, don't. There's no one working there anyway. You have to require the people to be residents of that neighborhood, primary residents, and the companies to be located there. No payroll tax, either employer or employee in those neighborhoods either. All right? And again, you're not losing any money because no one's working there now anyway. Number three, a thorough review of building codes, regulations, restrictions, and requirements to make sure that they're not anti-economic growth. Have you ever seen the building codes in the city of Chicago? 475 volumes, 2,000 pages per volume, 67 footnotes per page. I mean, no one has a clue except for the crooks and ripper offers on there. I mean, that's the only thing they're doing. And then the last one is you got to get rid of the minimum wage, and especially in kids. These kids there, they aren't worth $15 an hour. And so they can't get their first job. And after being unemployed for a year or two, for some reason, they become unemployable. After being unemployable for a couple of years, they become hostile. And then you have to spend your fortune to protect yourselves from them. We need to bring these people back into the mainstream and provide them with the opportunities to grow. Don't balance down. Balance up. And bring these things. I mean, you need to have the training, the on-the-job training, to become a good employee. And you can't get that if you have to fight the minimum wage. It's just a disaster. That's enterprise zones. Well, you know my talks on that, and I'll be quiet there. But our society has to be inclusive in growth. It's an opportunity for everyone in this world. And the best way to do it is to get government off your back, not put it on your back. In Philadelphia today, a woman, with single mother with a child, all right, if she's making $29,000 a year income, and if you look at her after-tax income and then look at all the social welfare benefits she gets legally at that $29,000 a year income, you can get the total amount of spending power she has with her child. You with me? If that woman decides to work her tush off and go up to $59,000 a year income, her total spending power will be the exact same. The reason is she loses all of her social welfare benefits because of the cutoffs, and she gets taxed on payroll taxes, income taxes on the mother. She faces 100% income tax from $29,000 to $59,000, and you wonder why we have a poverty trap in America. These are the things we have to go at right now, and to bring these people back into society before we lose everyone. Well, I lectured enough there. Next question right here. But
this is going to be our last question, okay. And it's going to be right over here.
So, Art, I have a lot of friends in L.A., up in Silicon Valley, entrepreneurs, tech sector, et cetera, et cetera. So many of them are against the Trump tax cuts. They think that IRTA was terrible. They think TEFRA was terrible. To this day, all the debates I have with them, I just want to know what your thoughts would be. What do you say to successful entrepreneurs who essentially think that tax cuts are terrible, and you'd think that they would be so in favor of things that, you know, fuel private enterprise?
You know, the word that comes to mind is idiot savant. You know, just because you're good at developing a silicon transistor doesn't mean you know how to add. Then, you know, they don't know their economics and they don't see how it works. But if you look at cross-section time series, any of these things there, you look at it. I had a debate with Jason Furman, Wall Street Journal sponsored, up in New York, and you know what he said was going to happen. This was in 2017. If the bill passed, and what I said. Go look at that debate. You know, if any of you want a copy of that paper, I'll be glad to send it to you. But, you know, the results are you cannot tax an economy into prosperity. Just pure and simple. A poor person cannot spend himself into wealth. It just doesn't happen that way. If you tax people who work and you pay people who don't work, do I need to say the next sentence to you? If you have two locations, A and B, if you raise taxes in B and you lower them in A, producers and manufacturers and people are going to move from? Am I going way over your heads? I mean, you know, you look at this thing and you just sit there and say, I don't get it, how they don't understand. You know, what was it Forrest Gump said? I forget, something like that. Thank you very much.
Dr. Laffer, can I ask you to stay up here for just a minute? So we're very efficient here, so we've got a little X on the on the carpet for you. That's just for you. So if you join us regularly for these programs, this is typically where we'd be wrapping up, but I've asked Dr. Laffer to stay on stage for a moment longer for a special presentation. And I'd like to ask Mark and Raj to come back up here as well. We may even have X's for you. That's, we appreciate your remarks, appreciate you traveling to be here with us. Your insights, your wisdom, your impeccable scholarship are always greatly appreciated, especially your humor and optimism that I always find infectious and very Reagan-esque, of course. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Andrew Coffin. I have the privilege of serving as the director of the Reagan Ranch for Young America's Foundation. And, you know, as Mark mentioned earlier in the program, today we mark the anniversary of what the Washington Post called one of the most remarkable demonstrations of presidential leadership in U.S. history. Ronald Reagan certainly deserves credit for launching the largest and longest economic boom in the 20th century. But of course, the successful passage of the 81 tax cuts did not start here in Santa Barbara at the Reagan Ranch, or even with key allies in Congress like Jack Kemp. This was a victory that can be traced back to the birth of the modern conservative movement and to the hearty band of freedom-loving patriots that emerged in the 1960s and 1970s. To craft the policies and ideas that fueled the Reagan Revolution. A few months prior to signing the Economic Recovery Tax Act, a newly inaugurated President Ronald Reagan gave a memorable address at CPAC celebrating these great conservative victories of the 1980 election. And in typical Reagan fashion, he was quick to give credit to others. He said, "History must also say that our victory, when it was achieved, was not so much a victory of politics as it was a victory of ideas, not so much a victory of any one man or party as it was a victory for a set of principles that were protected and nourished by a few unselfish Americans through many grim and heartbreaking defeats." And certainly one among these unselfish Americans who played a dramatic role in shaping Ronald Reagan's commitment to smaller government and lower taxes is the man we just heard from and now honor today with a Lifetime Achievement Award, Dr. Art Laffer.
Oh my
So it is appropriate today, as we mark the anniversary of the signing of the historic Reagan tax cuts, to recognize and honor the achievements of one of the early Reagan allies who helped pave the way for this historic occasion. Raj has already done a very fine job introducing Dr. Laffer, but it's worth remembering again that Art Laffer came to prominence during those dark days of the Carter era, 1970s, by championing income tax reductions and a stable dollar. This magic formula for economic growth became Ronald Reagan's playbook for economic policy, laying the groundwork for a decades-long economic expansion, not just in the United States, but around the world. And it was also central to Ronald Reagan's strategy to use economic might to defeat the Soviet Union and win the Cold War. Estimates suggest that the economic expansion of the 80s and 90s lifted 1 billion people across the globe from extreme poverty worldwide, and the dissolution of the Soviet Union unshackled hundreds of millions of more. Dr. Laffer is justifiably known as the father of supply-side economics for these accomplishments, but as we all know, he is not one to rest on his laurels. He is still in the thick of the fight for economic and personal freedom, advising the current administration, and as Raj said, barnstorming campuses across the country, bringing his winsome, optimistic message to thousands of young people. In 1985, Ronald Reagan was presented with an official tax axe by Alabama Senator Jeremiah Denton, and though it is not quite a Presidential Medal of Freedom, we could think of no better way to honor Dr. Laffer for his contributions to our cause than to present him with his own replica tax axe here today.
Yeah.
So, with that, beautiful.
Oh,
moment.
My God. Oh, my Lord.
Perfect. Oh, my God.
What I wondered was what was that adjective, winsome?
Winsome person.
When I'm described as winsome, there's a desperation in the society.
Well, if you would allow me to, it says tax X on one side, and then there's an inscription on the other, and I'll read the inscription aloud. It says, Young America's Foundation recognizes Dr. Arthur Laffer for his lifetime of achievements, including revolutionizing economic thought through his contribution of the Laffer Curve, his advisory roles with Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher, and his enthusiastic articulation of free market principles to young people through his partnership with Young America's Foundation. Presented by Young America's Foundation, to Dr. Arthur Laffer at the Reagan Ranch Center on the 12th day of August, the year of our Lord, 2019, to honor the anniversary of President Reagan's historic signing of the 1981 Economic Recovery Tax Act at Rancho del Cielo. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Well, all I can say is thank you, thank you, thank you. And lower the microphone. It's just...
Thank you again. We do advise you not to put that in your check bags. We'll ship it to you, or your carry-on, I should say. Again, we are delighted, as always, to have each one of you with us for a Reagan Ranch Roundtable, and a very special Reagan Ranch Roundtable. I believe that this year, as with almost every year, we're the only site in the country celebrating Ronald Reagan's 1981 tax cuts and that particular anniversary, but an incredibly important anniversary to continue to mark, not only celebrating those accomplishments, Dr. Laffer's role, Ronald Reagan's bold leadership, but the principles behind them as we face the challenges in our own day. On July 27th, 1981, Ronald Reagan actually gave a nationally televised address defending and supporting his Economic Recovery Tax Act. And he made his appeal not to Congress, not to the political elites, but instead directly to the American people, something our current president is very good at doing. And he ended his address with these words, I've not taken your time this evening merely to ask you to trust me. Instead, I ask you to trust yourselves. That's what America is all about. Our struggle for nationhood, our unrelenting fight for freedom, our very existence, these have all rested on the assurance that you must be free to shape your life as you are best able to. That no one can stop you from reaching higher or take from you the creativity that has made America the envy of mankind. One road is timid and fearful, the other bold and hopeful. It's been the power of millions of people like you who have determined that we will make America great again. You have made the difference up to now. You will make the difference again. Let us not stop now. Thank you, God bless, and good night. Thank you again. We'll look forward to seeing you next month. Thank you, Wendy. Thank you, Dr. Laffer.